we're going to start today with one with a program that I'd already opened. It showed up around Christmas time, and I opened it up because I wasn't sure if it was a gift for somebody or not. This is from the Memphis Mad Dogs, who played it only 1 year in the Canadian Football League when the Canadian Football League had its ill-fated expansion to the United States. This is their game from July 7th, 1995 in Memphis against the BC Lions. And we'll take a quick look through here. If this gets done fast enough, I have another program on standby. Here's the CFL commissioner, Larry Smith. Larry, also, I'm going to try, this doesn't open up very well, so I'm going to have to hold this a little differently. Larry Smith was the was a player before becoming commissioner for the Montreal Alouettes. Great moments in football. That's Mervin Fernandez. Sorry, the glossy pages when I film in here, it does tend to get a glare, and I apologize for that. Fernandez would eventually play some NFL ball after this. He would be a receiver for a few years with the Los Angeles Raiders. Grey Cup regular time. Former Redskins standout Joe Theismann started his career in the CFL with the Toronto Argonauts. And took Toronto to the Grey Cup, where they would lose to the Calgary Stampeders. And there's another CFL quarterback, J.C. Watts, who was one of the Oklahoma Sooner wishbone quarterbacks and would later become a congressman from the state of Oklahoma. Watts was quite a good quarterback for the Ottawa Rough Riders there. I'm trying to get a spot where I don't quite get as much glare. Let's see if we can move over here, if that helps us a little bit here. Not so much. Let's go back to where we were. There's a little kids' corner where you fun with logos, where you can, that's the Winnipeg Blue Bombers and the Toronto Argonauts and the Mad Dogs. Oh, that's that. You know what? That is a very nice touch that too many football programs do not have. That you, not a lot of people score football in the programs because they just really don't have a place for it. But right here, that is very nice. That is a great idea. I wish more would do that. And right over here is Workout Like Mad Dogs, the official workout facility of the Memphis Mad Dogs. They had a pretty cool looking logo, I have to say. That is, I really like their logo, and their colors were green and yellow. And there's CFL schedules. And I guess this was some kind of contest for people that bought the program. I tell you, of the CFL teams, that is clearly the best, of the CFL American teams, clearly the best logo. Second best, the San Antonio Texans, who looks like a lot like Undertaker from wrestling. There's it's the Mad Dogs owners, Frederick Smith, who owns FedEx to this day. The majority shareholder in FedEx. And there's their head coach, Pepper Rogers, who also was the head coach of the Memphis Showboats of the USFL. And Steve Earhart, who was the general manager of the Memphis Showboats. See, there's a lot of connections between the Memphis teams at that time. And there's a neat little, the differences in CFL and American football, where they show the field. And if I remember right, the Memphis playing in the Liberty Bowl, they had to, stretch the rules a little bit because the Liberty Bowl couldn't accommodate a full Canadian Football League field. So they're, I can't remember if it was on the sidelines or their end zones were smaller. But they had to accommodate that. As you can see right there is the layout of the Liberty Bowl. Let's see if we can get a non-glare picture. Let's try that. There we go. As you can see, the field took literally every extra space that they had because of the CFL dimensions being longer and wider. And here's the Mad Dogs itself. Damon Allen, a longtime CFL Hall of Famer, played the younger brother of Marcus Allen, Gary Anderson, who was a running back in the USFL and in the with and the NFL with both Tampa Bay Bandits and Bucks. Trying to see if any of these names. Tim Cofield was a very good CFL defensive back. Or a linebacker, I believe, pass rusher. And somewhere in here is Joe Horn, because I know he played on this team. Before he went to the Kansas City Chiefs, and best known for his days with the New Orleans Saints. I'm trying to see if I can find Joe on here. Oh, there he is. He's all the way up at the top. Joe Horn, best known for his longtime career in New Orleans and for pulling a cell phone out of the end zone. We have the Hound Becomes a Mad Dog, which is an article on Gary Anderson, who was one of my favorite USFL players, even though I wasn't really a Tampa Bay Bandits fan. Spent time with the Chargers and in the, I think it was the Tampa Bay Buccaneers in the NFL. Mad Dogs and Crazy Clowns, which that was a blast for those of you clown fans. There's the Memphis numerical roster. The official hot dog of the Memphis Mad Dogs, Brian Hot Dogs. More shots of the logo. And there's their helmet, which that is a cool helmet, gotta say. And there's a, this is a classy program, I have to tell you. There's a flip card that has the each team's roster and how they expect to start, the depth chart. Wow. So there's NFL programs that could take quite a note from this program that is now 25 years old. My God, time flies. There's each team's numerical roster and the Lions' alphabetical roster. And where you can get your official Mad Dogs merchandise. I do apologize for the glare. When I do at the home office, this is going to be an issue. I can see that coming. The Liberty Bowl, which is where they still play to this day. And there's the mascot, which I guess his name is... What is it? Alien. Thought it said Alvin for a minute. Being a Mad Dog has its privileges. There's some partners. The Mad Dog Radio Network. Satellite television. Cost less than cable. There's the CFL address book with the various teams. I have to say, when you look at these logos... Although I'm in the CFL, I root for the Hamilton Tiger Cats. That Mad Dog logo is easily the best in this league. Although for some reason, the Birmingham Barracudas are not on here. Oh, there we go, other side. There's Edmonton, BC, Birmingham, Memphis, and the San Antonio Texans. Doesn't that look like the Undertaker? You should have sued him for infringements. CFL rushing and passing. Mike Pringle, one of the better running backs in CFL history of Baltimore. And this is the tradition because for this year only, because of the U.S. teams, and when that ended at the end of the season, all the Canadian teams are in one division, so they had a North and South. And there's Doug Flutie, quarterback in the Calgary Stampeders in this particular season. And there's his brother Darren on the BC Lions. And some of the CFL terms that are familiar to CFL fans. And right beside there, Platinum Plus, the Gentleman's Choice. Amateur dance contest every Saturday, $350. And this is a Memphis mailbag here. And there's Gary Lewis, who I think he wound up spending a little bit of time in the NFL. And not to be confused with Gary Lewis and the Playboys of Everybody Loves a Clown fame. We're going to try to go through this one real quick. It's a wrestling program, so it shouldn't take long. This is from a card that I went to in Hagerstown. And there's the one of the TRS all-time favorites, the Masked Superstar. And there's the Masked Superstar clinching in. This is the funny stuff. This was just before they started to expand, when you didn't see wrestling stuff for sale all the time. You could get the WWF Windbreaker, the tote bag. And there's going to be a note in here that I'm going to... There's Bob Backlund, still the champion at this point, but the reign's winding down as he seeks revenge against Sergeant Slaughter, the insidious drill instructor. And there's the TRS favorite, the Magnificent Morocco, and his big feud with Jimmy Snuka. Now, this one here, when I saw this, I was 15 when this card occurred. And I've written many times of my childhood hero, the Magnificent Morocco. And my mom actually ordered me one of these shirts, and they sent the check back. Not that it bounced, they just said the company went out of business. I've never seen this shirt anywhere. But you could tell they were already beginning the marketing. There's a quick interview with Mr. USA, Tony Atlas. And then they're talking about the various matches on the circuit. Mr. Fuji and Tiger Chung Lee, a new tag team. There's SD Jones, who had a near tragic event when he was injured by the Wild Samoans. And there's Fuji and Chung Lee. This is the WWF gym shorts. Now, don't they look great? $6 and $1 postage and handling. They look spectacular. Very 80s. So this looks like Andre the Giant, Tito Santana, Ivan Putski, and Rocky Johnson. There's a cheesy trucker cap or a belt buckle. Doesn't need that. George the Animal Steel against Pat Patterson. Salvatore Bellomo nearly unlacing in the mystery of Iron Mike Sharp's arm brace. And then there's Big John Studd on the back. I went to this card. This was here in Hagerstown on October 27th, 1983, on a Thursday night. So that meant school the next day. And the main event was supposed to be the red-hot feud between Jimmy Snuka and the Magnificent Morocco. And Morocco, for some reason, couldn't make it, replaced by Ivan Koloff. And Snuka pinned Koloff. And the Wild Samoans retained their tag team title over the Invaders, who one of the Invaders was Jorge Gonzalez, who wound up later killing Bruiser Brody in Puerto Rico. There's the aforementioned Mr. Fuji with a pinfall over Tony Garea. Tito Santana over one of my all-time favorite enhancement talent, Charlie Fulton. Never got a big break. And then, surprisingly, the Tonga Kid was getting a big push for being Jimmy Snuka's supposed nephew. But yet he went to a draw with Bob Bradley. Go figure. Okay, so I've got two programs in today. So we'll try to do an opening tomorrow. For the next one, I just happened to see that Mad Dog and Lions and go ahead and get that done. So until next time, hope you enjoy this one, and we'll have an opening video next time.